I want to actually see if I can test your abilities with randomness. If you can do me something, do me a favor. So, you know, flipping a coin, heads or tails. All right, so I want you to be a coin flipper in your mind. And I want you to flip a coin in your mind randomly 20 times and write down the result here, but don't show me.
All right, mate.
All right, we're ready
for
it?
I've done 20, yep.
You've done 20, okay. Now, I don't want to see.
All right.
But what's going to happen is I'm going to try and make money off your list. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a bunch of pennies and you don't have to pay me back. They're yours. And these are mine. I bet to play. And if I win, you give me that amount. And if I lose, you keep that amount. All right? So I'm just going to put a penny down. There's one penny riding on this. Mm. Okay, so my first prediction is that you flipped a head.
Yes.
Yes! So Brody says head. So I'm going to take one of your coins from your stack. Okay, I gave them to you anyway, so you shouldn't be too miffed. Put another coin in. Okay, I'm going to predict tails.
No.
Ooh, so you've said head. Okay, next, I'm going to predict tails.
No.
Not tails. Next, I'm going to predict tails. And I'm going to bet $20 that I'm right. What was it, heads or tails?
It was tails.
You owe me 20 bucks.
Okay. I don't remember agreeing to
that. So I'm just going to put that aside.
All right.
Shall we keep playing?
All right. It's not looking good all of a sudden.
I'm going to bet another coin. Just remember you owe me 20 US. I want it in US if that's okay.
All right.
Okay. I'm going to bet another coin.
All right.
I'm going to predict tails.
Yes.
It is tails?
Yes.
Okay. Tails it is. All right. So I get another coin there. I'm going to predict heads. I'm going to predict tails.
Yep.
Tails it is. So that was another coin from you. Heads?
No.
No? Okay, so you get to keep that. Tails?
No, mate, it's a head.
It's a head, so you get that. Heads? Heads it is.
Yep.
All right, so I get another coin from you. This is turning out all right. Remember you got the 20 to give me.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to predict tails.
Yep.
It is a tail.
Yeah.
So I get another coin from you. Heads.
Yeah.
It is a head. Okay, I'm going to predict a tail. Is it a tail?
No.
Tail?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to predict a head.
No.
Okay, you get that coin. I'm going to predict another head.
Yep.
It was a head, so I get a coin from you. Tail.
Yep.
It was a tail. I'm going to predict another tail.
No.
It's a head, so I'm going to predict a head.
Correct.
Last one. For $100, tail.
Yeah.
It is a tail?
Yeah.
Yes! That was expensive. You should have listened to the way I said this. You've done something fantastic for me. You have been really bad at creating random sequences. As I can see here, the longest run that you've had is right at the beginning. It was three heads. And then you've pretty much alternated between tails and heads. The most run that you've had of tails or heads is two in a row. And you showed a pattern there. This demonstrates something called the gambler's fallacy. The gambler's fallacy says that what's happened before has an impact of what will happen next. If we were using a coin, every time you flip it, there's an equal probability that you're going to get a head or a tail. Now, a lot of people think, well, how does that work? Because, you know, you're flipping coins, surely it's not very likely to have, you know, five heads in a row, six heads in a row. But this is the nature of randomness. Randomness is very lumpy, right? And lumpiness means that you do get streaks, which is part of the gambler's lexicon, you know, is like we have a gambling streak. So you actually have not produced a very good random sequence.
I didn't put enough long streaks in.
You didn't put enough streaks in, no. This is actually would be termed homogeneous because it's actually quite mixed. The number of ways that we can have 20 heads or tails, the number of permutations we can have, is pretty big. So we can basically get a head or a tail in each position, and there's 20 positions. So the total number of permutations, not combinations, like fixed order, is 2^20. And that turns out to be 1,048,576. Because you've done a permutation which has a maximum streak of either three heads or three tails, you only had one little tiny streak right at the beginning, which is quite interesting, that is a subset of every single permutation. But this is actually representative of the way you think, and not just you, Brady. A lot of people think exactly like you. If they were to do random, they think mixed up, right? That's what people think. But random isn't mixed up. Random is random. In actual fact, it has a different nature to the idea of being mixed up. Because if it was evenly mixed up, as I've just shown, I've made a lot of money off you, you end up being predictable. And randomness is unpredictable. So I've actually crunched the numbers, and I can tell you how many permutations have a maximum of three heads or three tails as a streak. 242,830. So you can see that's a much smaller number than this. And in actual fact, it turns out to be 23.2% of all possible permutations. It's less than a quarter. So out of all the possible permutations you can have, the pool that you would choose from, okay, you're only getting 1 in 4. So you can see just by that logic alone why this, well, it's not random, all right?
Of course, Simon, I wasn't consciously limiting myself to streaks of three. I guess my brain was somehow.
Well, that's a natural thing to do because we think streaks are unlikely. We tend to think very small-mindedly. So if you were just dealing with, say, four in a row, having four heads or four tails in a row is actually in the minority because there's only one way you can get four heads in a row and only one way you can get four tails in a row. But we did 20. And so straight after you did four heads or four tails, imagine if after that you did head, tails, head, tails, head, tails. There's a whole heap of different permutations you can get which at the beginning have four heads or four tails. Now that's part of how randomness works, is the fact that, sure, if you're dealing with a small sample, you can expect things to be quite mixed up, but that's because there's not many permutations. Head, tail, head, tail, tail, head, tail, head is actually, you know, in the same ballpark number as big streaks. But when you're dealing with very long streaks, then you could have head, 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 and then you've still got all the permutations left to go, which is still a huge number. It's not just in that position. You could get a streak of six heads in a row or six tails in a row at any point. And if you do that, you end up with a whole bunch of permutations which have a streak of six heads or a streak of six tails. I've done this with school kids plenty of times, and what has happened in my empirical evidence, all right, is that you do have kids putting in a streak of four heads or four tails, but only once. They'll only do a maximum of once. So I actually crunched the numbers and I wanted to work out if how many permutations of 20 heads or tails where you had a maximum of three heads or three tails and just one streak of four. It's basically what you've done plus you also allow four heads or four tails.
But now, only once.
Only once. That's basically all of this plus one streak of four heads or four tails. I really had to crunch the numbers for this, I'm telling you. So the total number is 478,520. And that corresponds to 45.6% of all permutations.
Oh, that's bigger than I expected.
It is bigger, but it's still less than half. So this is kind of the limit of what your normally mathematically literate person thinks about randomness. They actually, over 20 flips of heads or tails, will actually cut out half of all permutations as possibilities. Now, half is pretty significant when we're talking about probability, right? It's like half. You actually get rounded down.
So you're telling me that over half of all the times I do this with a coin, I will have a streak of four.
Exactly.
Twice.
Exactly.
Twice or a streak of five or...
More streaks of four in a row and longer streaks. It's because I've chosen quite a lengthy number of flips. So we've done 20. If it's 16, it doesn't work as much. The nature of randomness really presents itself in the length of the number of flips. The way we can think about it is how predictable is your sequence. Really, all you need to know is there a way that you can write your sequence down of heads and tails? Is there a way to do it that it's simpler? And if there is some sort of order or pattern to it, then you can actually make it simpler. But if your sequence is actually very complicated, it's actually harder to write it any smaller than it is. And there is a way of categorizing a random sequence by saying the easiest way to write this sequence down is just write it. The DNA sequence, which makes up me and the fabulous person you are, Brady, is actually a near random sequence. Because the DNA sequence contains so much information, it actually, in a way, contains lots of patterns. So the way you can think of randomness is it's something that actually has patterns on patterns on patterns on patterns, and actually fits in very much with the way gamblers think, where they say, oh, I can see a pattern here. I can predict what's going to happen next. But that's just randomness at work. Randomness shows patterns, but there's no logic to it. It's not following rules of science or physics or anything. It's the way randomness is.
I just wish, if I just made that last one ahead, I would have won.
Yeah.
If I just made the last one ahead, and it still would have just been a streak of three.
Yeah, well, because...
You were lucky. You were just lucky.
No, well, because you proved to me that you weren't going to do it again.
I've done it once before.
You started big. This is basically, you did, this is like a Hollywood script. You start with a big action sequence at the beginning, and then it becomes formulaic.
A bit like this video.
Thanks.
Well, today's episode sponsor, Brilliant, is full of courses and quizzes and puzzles, and lots of them touch on the gambler's fallacy, randomness, probability, in all sorts of ways. And this is just a small smattering of the great bounty of stuff you're going to find on the site, which I'm sure you've heard me talk about before. It's amazing for mathematics, but there's also loads of science and computer science on there as well. Lots of it's free, but you can also get a premium membership that unlocks all sorts of other goodies. I know some of you are doing that already, but here's something you might not have thought of: buying someone else a Brilliant membership as a gift. It's so easy. With just a few clicks, you're giving someone you care about hours, days, maybe years of fun, education, entertainment. It's so hard coming up with thoughtful and original gifts for people these days. Someone in your life might really like this. Really clever, a little bit different. Go to brilliant.org/numberphile, follow the easy links to a gift subscription, and feed the brain of someone you care about.
Anything else?
Yeah, where's my money?